Good afternoon, everyone, and thanks for joining us for Grand Rounds. We've got a good-sized audience today. Thank you so much for making the effort to come down. Got a great Grand Rounds, great topic, invasive strep in the PICU, and a super great speaker. I do have a couple reminders. Number one, if you're joining us via Teams, be sure to make sure that you mute yourself when you come on. And also, don't mute all. Hit that by mistake, because then you're muting the speaker and no one can hear. So just mute yourself. At the end, for Q&A, questions and answers, Kristin will take them. It's best to do it via Teams. For those participating via Teams, unmute yourself and ask your question, and then Kristin will answer it. We don't always get to chat. We don't always get to all of those. We don't see them all. I don't have anyone that's like manning it per se, and we're back and forth. So the best way to get them in a timely answer is to just unmute yourself at the end when she calls for questions and answers. And then people in the audience are asked questions as well, which we're always happy to take. And then lastly, there will be no Grand Rounds for the next 2 weeks, February 15th. We had a speaker that unfortunately had to cancel. And then on February 22nd, that's Resident Appreciation Week. So there will be no Grand Rounds that week either. So then they will resume the first Wednesday in March, and I will get that notice out to everyone. So other than that, sit back, relax, and enjoy the show. And Dr. Later is going to be introducing Kristin. Thank you.
Yeah. Hi, everybody. Thanks, Sue. And I do want to apologize for not being in the atrium today. As if she knew what the schedule was going to be, my middle child came down with a strep infection. So as timely as can be. But I still wanted to take the opportunity to present today's speaker because she is one of my personal favorite people to work alongside, our very own Kristin Mikolajewski. Kristin is a graduate of The Ohio State University, where she got her master's in nursing science and her NP degree in pediatric acute care. She went on from there to receive her post-master's acute care training at Wright State University. She has been with us here at Dayton Children off and on since 2010 and pretty consistently since 2015 in the ICU, in the TCU. You guys have seen her around the halls here. Before that, she was also practicing over at Nationwide as an acute care nurse practitioner. So all in all, we are grateful that you are here. She is constantly involved in research and QI projects and extremely knowledgeable in her field. So without further ado, I am going to be listening very closely, Kristin, to invasive strep infections as I sit here nursing my own child to help.
Thank you, Dr. Later. I appreciate it. So good morning, good afternoon, and welcome. As Dr. Later said, my name is Kristin Mikolajewski. I'm a nurse practitioner here in our PICU. I've been a nurse practitioner for 13 years, and as she mentioned as well, a nurse practitioner over in the cardiac ICU at Nationwide Children's, and then for the past seven in our PICU here at Dayton Children's. So my presentation today is on invasive strep in the PICU, specifically about intracranial abscess or brain abscess. Okay, here we go. We got this. So just some acknowledgments. I just wanted to thank Dr. Patel, who's here supporting me. Thank you very much. All of our intensivists, just for helping me learn and helping me grow and always pushing me to the next level. I have them to thank and for be able to stand up here today. Also, Dr. Claudi, who's one of our Dayton Children's infectious disease physicians. He's always willing to stand around and geek out with me about this stuff. So thank you to him. Also, big thanks to Joe Day, who is our neurosurgery physician assistant. He spent quite a bit of time with me yesterday just going through some of our case study MRIs and CT scans, and I learned about a lot from him as well. So just wanted to thank him. And lastly, we will get to this at the end, but I have a special thank you to one of our special guests. Okay, so why am I here? Like, why are we talking about strep? I don't know if you guys heard the phrase TikTok made me do it or TikTok made me buy it. TikTok is my PICU. So PICU made me do it. I love the PICU because you see so many crazy things, but it also makes you obsess and perseverate over some of these crazy things. And over the past year, the thing that I have been perseverating about has been the number of children that we've seen with intracranial abscess. As I mentioned, I've been a nurse practitioner for 13 years. You know, I've seen one or two here and there, but it's been quite out of proportion, which has kind of piqued my interest. For example, just last month, we had four kids in a matter of 4 weeks. And to give you perspective, in 2016, we only had two kids. So to have four in 4 weeks versus two in a year, it's something that's quite different. So that's kind of what sparked my whole interest in giving this presentation. The objectives today, we're going to describe the recent concerns that we've seen for increased incidence of pediatric invasive strep and specifically intracranial abscess. I will go through our PICU data, and then I will present a case study that we have actually treated here in our PICU, and then lastly, I'll summarize everything up. So starting back in 2022, which is kind of went around, I'm like, this something's up, something's different. It was kind of the COVID era, and we started seeing more and more kids with orbital cellulitis intracranial abscess. Around that time, there were three cases that were reported to the CDC in California Children's. They had three children at one time that had a strep brain abscess. And along with that, other institutions across the country were kind of asking the same questions. So in June, the CDC called for clinicians and health departments to start reporting their cases. And then in September of 22, they actually published an article with their findings. So the two ways that the CDC collected data was one through the Children's Hospital Association, through the Pediatric Health Information Systems database, and then as well as the call for cases through to CDC. So for the first collection of data, they had 40 hospitals that contributed data. The population was patients less than 18 years of age. They looked at data from 2016 through 2022, and they're looking at primary and secondary diagnoses of extradural, subdural abscess, and intracranial abscess and granuloma. As far as the CDC's case, they were looking for patients with the diagnosis of brain abscess, epidural empyema, and subdural empyema. Again, children less than 18 years of age that were hospitalized between June 2021 through August 2022. And for the cases reported at the CDC, none of those patients had any prior neurosurgical procedures or trauma. For the PHIS database, as I mentioned, 40 hospitals, there were 3,078 cases reported. The median age for children that were hospitalized with intracranial abscess was 8 years of age. 65% of them were male, 45% were white, and varied across that time period with concurrent COVID. Now, mind you, when they called for this data, we are very much in the prime of COVID, so that's why they reported this out. But it ranged anywhere from 1.3 to 10.9% of the patients in any given time had COVID at the time they were admitted for a brain abscess. The chart that you see is here on the left, we have number of cases, and down at the bottom is discharge date from 2016 to 2022. And you see it kind of fluctuates, but they have a little note over there where onset of COVID, it actually drops the incidence of brain abscess. But then here starting in 2021, there was a peak. And it was interesting, the data that they found, and over those past 6 years, they found that there always seemed to be a spike in March, which I thought was interesting. As for the CDC, there were 94 cases reported. Of those, 81 met the actual case definition as defined by the CDC. The median age was 11. 61% were males, 54% were white. 61% had a documented respiratory infection within 6 weeks prior to hospitalization. Concurrent illness of those 61%, 26% had documented sinusitis, and 18% actually had COVID. And remember, this data, instead of the span of 2016 to 22, this data was basically 2021 to 2022. So that's probably why the COVID is higher in this population. Common presenting symptoms were headache, nausea, vomiting, photophobia. And then severe cases, neurologic deficits and seizures. 81% of those kids did seek outpatient care prior to the hospitalization, and 2.8% of them did not survive. The infectious organisms that were isolated from these patients, they found 41% had strep intermedius, 18% had streptococcus anginosis, and then 28% was a non-streptococcal pathogen. So what did the CDC conclude? Much to my dismay, the CDC concluded this was not a thing that we all know that post-viral bacterial infections, they're not new. This is not a new phenomenon. But from my perspective, I just felt like there was an increase in incidence. But given the review of the data from the CDC, they concluded there was no excess pediatric brain infections during the pandemic. On the positive side, of the abscesses that they saw, none of the strep isolates were super resistant, so that's a good thing. They didn't find anything weird genetically about these the strep isolates they were finding. There was no monster bug that was causing all of these strep infections. They did notice, or they did note, limitations of the data. So data was voluntary for the CDC. For the PHIS, there were only 40 institutions that reported data. So, of course, we are missing a big chunk, but at least it's something to start from. And they also acknowledged, obviously, we need to continue to monitor the situation. So that was the CDC's conclusions, right? So my conclusion... I was out on this like quest to prove the CDC wrong, okay? So what I did is I went back. Sorry, let's stop. It'll end, I promise. Okay. I went back through our past 5 years of data and looked at all of the admissions that we had for intracranial abscess. And I did it through our electronic medical record system, one of our systems. It's called Slicer Dicer. And my query looked for primary diagnosis of intracranial abscess, epidural abscess, subdural abscess, and then just in general brain abscess. I also included people that may or may not have had craniotomy or endoscopic sinus surgery. And I also excluded kids that had neurosurgical procedures and or trauma. So this is just a little taste, and Dr. Clotty gave a talk about invasive group-based strep before, so I want to thank him for tag-teaming this with me. This is, at the beginning of the presentation, I talked about how we had four or five kids in a matter of 4 or 5 weeks, and to me, that's significant, you know, just my humble opinion. But just to give you perspective, these are real cases that happened in about the past 6 weeks. So we had a 13-year-old that tested positive flu A, came in with 7 days of headache, nasal congestion, had a pansinusitis and intracranial epidural abscess due to strep, which is consistent with the data that the CDC found. Next, a 14-year-old with flu A as well that was found to have pansinusitis and subdural empyema, this time due to MRSA. We had another 12-year-old with flu-like symptoms, not diagnosed, that came in with headache and new onset dysarthria and slurred speech, was found to have a subdural empyema due to strep constellatus. And then we had a 13-year-old that came with fevers, headache, myalgia, also positive for flu A, who was admitted with pansinusitis and subdural empyema due to strep intermedius. So as you can see, working in the PICU, it gives you a little bit of a, it was significant. I'll just say that. So review of our actual PICU data. So again, I went through January 2018 to January 2023. I found a total of 18 cases in our PICU during that time. For those cases, the median age was 8. 72% of them were male and 89% required surgical intervention. And the top right there, that orange box, it kind of breaks it down by case. You can see for 2018, 2019, and 2020, we only had 2 per year. And then if you take a look at 2022, we had 8. So to me, that is significant. The CDC, when they had call for cases, they stopped collecting data in August. And to be quite honest, a lot of our cases that we had here were after that time frame. So I'm very much looking forward to the continued data, and hopefully I'll be up here at some time again at a later date reporting back some more data for you all. The bottom left corner of the green shows concurrent cases for our kiddos here at Dayton Children. So 11% of them had COVID at that time. 11% had influenza A, 6% had RSV, and 72% did not have any viral illness identified. Just a caveat to that, most of those 72% were in the 2018-2019 pre-COVID era where we didn't send respiratory panels on everybody. So a lot of those kiddos either were negative and or didn't have a respiratory panel sent because they presented with neurosymptoms. Last but not least, on the bottom right, kind of the same of the same, the organisms that we were able to isolate from our cases were very similar. We had strep intermedius, strep constellatus, strep pneumonia, and then we had already talked about the MRSA. What does this mean? We don't know. As I said, we don't know yet, but there's more to come. But what we do know, this Dr. Claudia will be very proud of me for saying this, we do know that the influenza vaccine does decrease your risk for secondary invasive strep infection. So one of the big takeaways is, yes, the flu vaccine works. Yes, they have documented that. So please, please get your flu vaccine. Obviously, continued data is needed. And right now, there aren't any formal guidelines as far as the management of pediatric intracranial abscess. We have some idea, but hopefully some of this data that they're gathering will help us come up with that as well. Some of the takeaways for those of you that don't work inpatient, this is, again, thank you to Dr. Claudia from the Health Advisory Network from the CDC. As we mentioned, prompt vaccination for flu A and varicella. Consider group A strep or any strep for that matter as a sign of invasive disease, particularly those kids that have been sick and then got better and then came back sick again. Obtain cultures when you can as an indicated. Notify your local state and health departments. And just being mindful of, with the national shortage of amoxicillin, just being mindful of the alternate treatment options, which I know you guys are all very much aware. So this is the meat and potatoes of the presentation. We have seen so many intracranial abscess in the PICU, and this one case in particular, it not only hit my heart, but it was also quite terrifying and just very eye-opening on how sick these kids can be. So I chose to present this case study we have here, a 13-year-old female. She presented to an outside hospital with concerns for 2 weeks of headaches and about 4 days of fever, chills, and fatigue. I had the opportunity to talk to her mom, and she was saying she kind of thought maybe it was a hormone thing. She was just kind of off. You know, maybe her menstrual cycle was coming up, but knew something was off. Her appetite was down. Wasn't really sure about that, and she seemed kind of tired the few days coming up. And I think she had said, you know, a couple days before going in, she had wanted to go hang out with her friends. She wasn't feeling great. She wanted to go hang out with her friends, and her mom was like, okay, but you have to eat something. And she could only consume six Ritz crackers. And then the following day, she was just sleeping. And I believe they had to get up to go somewhere to a doctor's appointment. And at that point, she couldn't even wake up from her nap. So that's what kind of prompted, okay, let's go. So they went to an outside hospital ED. And I will get to the rest of that in just the next slide. But just as reference for her past medical history, just some mild anxiety, depression, and ADHD. Routine meds was only guanfacine, so otherwise really very healthy child that presented. At the outside hospital ED, she was encephalopathic. Her GCS was 10. Surprisingly, her vital signs were otherwise normal, and she was maintaining her airway. She was in room air, and SATs were 98%, but she was obtunded. The initial concern, mom was saying, was really for drug ingestion. Sadly, we do see a lot of those. I know we do, and particularly in our preteens and teenage kids. That was kind of the initial pathway that the hospital took. And mom was saying, she kept saying, like, no, I know. Like, of course, we all know our kids. But I know something's wrong. So they initially just started with a drug screen, which was negative. And then they ended up going down a neurologic pathway. Which mom's gut is always right. So just going down the list here, what they found was she was in flu A positive. She was negative for COVID. Her white blood cell count was 20,000. Her procalcitonin was elevated at 1.84. She was dehydrated with a BUN of 25. I put the blood gas up there. It's essentially normal, a little bit of metabolic acidosis, but quite surprising that she was maintaining her airway and didn't have, you know, respiratory acidosis, given her neurostatus. Her other labs that were normal were her troponin, her lactate, her LFT, her thyroid, and her CK. Blood and urine cultures were obtained, and as mentioned, her hemodynamics were quite stable. So as you can see here, I wonder if I can use this. This is the image from her initial MRI. There we go. Okay. This right here shows you, this is the left frontoparietal subdural fluid collection right here, kind of lighting up in white. That's what they're talking about. And it's causing that line down the middle here is showing you the midline shift. Oh, no. What did I do? Okay. Just kidding. So midline shift obviously is not normal. And then those kind of white, those white slits there, those are her ventricles, which are effaced, which again is not normal. They should be wide open and they're compressed. So that is concerning, which is why she was appropriately transferred down here to Dayton Children's. Specifically on the CT, it showed a sinusitis on that left side and also evidence of uncal herniation, which is quite concerning as well, and I'll get to that. I just put this image down here. This is a diffused weighted image from an MRI, which I thought was pretty cool. So again, Joe Day spent some time, our neurosurgery physician assistant, spent some time with me yesterday. We were reviewing these images, and the DWI image is very helpful in determining between hemorrhage or infection. And you can see here on her left side, this is like hyper attenuated. So that's more so concerning for infection versus hemorrhage. So I thought that was a pretty interesting image. This right here is just demonstrating uncal herniation. You can kind of see right here where that yellow arrow is pointing. There should be more space there, and there's not. And that is scary. You can also see just a little bit of cerebellar tonsil herniation, not quite terrible, but it is there. And then this image here on the left is kind of just showing all the different types of herniation. And the one specifically, the uncal herniation, is here number one, and then down here number six for the cerebellar tonsil herniation. So as mentioned, she was transferred to Dayton Children's. Prior to transfer, per our ED doc's recommendations, she was given a dose of Keppra and Decadron. She didn't really have any frank seizure activity at that time, but given the findings of midline shift, certainly high risk, and Decadron was for cerebral edema. She was given broad-spectrum antibiotics. At this point, they weren't sure if it was a meningitis, if it was an abscess, encephalitis. So the goal is to give broad spectrum. So they did give cefepime, vancomycin, and acyclovir, and they did give her 2 liters of fluid resuscitation. Between the time of coming to our ED, she progressed pretty quickly and was quite obtunded. She was unresponsive, sternal rub only. She was not speaking. She was still breathing on her own, but GCS was 7. Despite that, her pupils were still equal and reactive. Given her neurostatus, she was intubated for airway protection. Neurosurgery and ENT were immediately consulted. And after reviewing the image I just showed you with the midline shift and evidence of herniation, they quite appropriately took her to the OR for an emergent craniotomy. So she actually had 2 surgeries, our neurosurgery team and our ENT team. It was pretty cool. They coordinated and got her in the OR right away. They took her officially for a craniotomy for subdural empyema evacuation. In the OR note, it was noted that the brain was very tight prior to dural opening, despite giving her some mannitol, and the brain tissue was friable. The subdural fluid, or pus, to be frank, that was under the brain was under high pressure. The second procedure that she underwent was a nasal endoscopy with maxillary and gastrostomy, ethmoidectomy, sphenoidectomy, and frontal sinusotomy with our ENT team. And they just did a sinus washout. At this point, she was admitted to our PICU. As I mentioned before, there's really no evidence-based guidelines for the treatment of children with intracranial abscess. That we kind of, you know, have a somewhat of a pathway that's pretty consistent among the nation, but this is kind of like the circle of care that most hospitals will provide for a child with intracranial abscess. So the big thing is brain rest for the next 24, 48, 72 hours. After any time with a brain injury, your risk for cerebral edema for swelling continues to go up, and it's higher at that 48-hour, 72-hour mark. So that's the reason for the brain rest. So we initiated neuroprotection measures, which include, you know, head midline, head a bed up. We maintain normothermia. I don't know if you guys know, there's something in the PICU called targeted temperature management. It's, the brand name is Arctic Sun, but it's a pretty cool thing. It almost has these sticky blankets that goes on the patient's abdomen and extremities, and it controls the body temperature of the patient. Because anytime your body temperature go up, it increases your metabolic demand, and we don't want any demand on the brain. We want brain rest. So that was one of the tools that we were able to use. Also high-dose steroids. She was on Decadron 4 milligrams Q6, and that's for the cerebral edema, the swelling, and then also seizure prophylaxis with Keppra and fosphenytoin. Of course, neuromonitoring, every 15 minutes, every hour, it was very touch and go at that time. Specifically, we're looking for Cushing's triad, which is indicative of increased ICP and impending herniation, and that's hypertension and bradycardia, abnormal breathing pattern. Also maintaining her airway, again, for neuroprotection. So she was on mechanical ventilation, and after her sinus washout, ENT had us doing every 4-hour sinus irrigations. Maintaining her hemodynamics. So anytime the brain is injured, obviously cerebral perfusion is of key importance. So her compensatory mechanisms were intact, and she was actually hypertensive, so we didn't have to worry about that. So just to give you perspective, our MAP goals were anywhere from 90 to 100, but she did not require any pressors at that time. She was already hypertensive. And then, of course, we continued her on cefepime, flagyl, vancomycin, and also with the flu A positive, she was started on Tamiflu. Blood, urine, and abscess cultures from the operating room were pending at that time. So PICU care, hospital day one, post-op day zero, she was admitted, immediate post-op care. On hospital day two, there was really no change. The name of the game, when we're talking to family, the name of the game is rest, steady. We're not changing anything. We're just giving some time for everything to calm down. Nothing much on day two. On day three, her heart rate started to drop, but was drifting into the 40s. Her blood pressure also started to increase further, with systolics into the 150s, diastolics into the 100s. She was also having some junctional beats, some arrhythmia, which was concerning. Obviously, talking with our neurosurgery team, the concern at that time is for bradycardia, hypertension, is for increasing intracranial pressure. So we initiated hyperosmolar therapy on her, which is, we did this in the form of a 3% drip. We also, at that time, we had her pretty heavily sedated for brain rest, but one of the challenges is when you're sedating a patient heavily, then you can't really get an accurate neuro exam. So you're getting neuro checks, but how accurate are they if it's potentially she's not responsive to due to the sedation? So we actually stopped the sedation at that time. Her pupils were equal and reactive, but still unresponsive, despite discontinuing the sedation. At that time, neurosurgery said, okay, it's time to get an MRI. So the MRI showed worsening of her midline shift. You can see there in the middle, initially was red as an 8, and now it was 10.5 millimeter. It showed continued signs of uncal herniation and then brainstem compression, which was what was causing the bradycardia and hypertension. It showed worsening diffusion changes concerning for stroke. It also showed a non-occlusive thrombus in her superior sagittal sinus, so a clot in the vasculature of the brain. So when they saw this at that point, they said, okay, we got to do something. And I thought, I love neurosurgery. I love it. I just think it's so fascinating. And it kind of all goes back to the Monroe-Kelly doctrine. That's kind of one of the fundamentals of what we do. So I thought it would be helpful to review it today. So the Monroe-Kelly doctrine has to do kind of with like the black box of the cranium. So our skull, our cranium, is a fixed, non-compressible compartment, meaning it's a fixed volume and there's only so much pressure it can hold. The three components within our cranial compartment are blood, CSF, and brain tissue. And when you introduce something, you can see that little brown spot there, whether it be a mass, whether it be an abscess, that the volume is fixed. You're adding more volume. So the brain can only do so much to compensate for that volume until it can't. And the only thing it has to do is for the brain to herniate outward, which obviously is not good. So that is what the neurosurgeons were seeing on our patient's scans. Even after the first craniotomy, they drained. You know, obviously, we always try the least invasive if we can. And you don't ever want to go back to the OR if you don't have to. But at this point in time, it was life or death. And they did end up taking her back. So I love this picture. I just think this is so fascinating. What they did was a decompressive craniectomy. It's called a hemicraniectomy. Basically took the bone off kind of the entire left side of her skull. And the reason for that is decompressing the brain, basically relieving pressure off the brain. And this is through MRI or CT. They can do the 3D construction, which is pretty neat. You can see there on the that left, let me see if I can point it out for you, that like left picture right here, that is a right-sided frontal ICP monitor, intracranial pressure monitor. And then the other things you can see in there is the those lines. It's an epidural drain, just kind of a post-op surgical drain. So after her second surgery, she was admitted back to the PICU, and kind of over the next 7 days, it was very much a roller coaster. It was very much touch and go. It was, to be quite honest, there were times, you know, we had discussions with the parents that were not sure, you know, that this could be life or death. And if she does survive, we're not quite sure what the neurologic deficits were. We mentioned before she did have a thrombus. She did have evidence of a stroke. And her neuro exam initially when we took her off the sedation was not good. So it was a very scary time. She had intermittent peaks in her intracranial pressure during that time up to 30. And it was just a lot of, you know, giving 3%, giving mannitol, sedating, paralyzing, temperature management, anything. And truthfully, it was kind of the thought was not a great prognosis at that point. Nothing really much changed other than that the cultures did come back. So the intra-op fluid, the abscess fluid cultures did come back positive for strep intermedius. There was scrant staph epidermidis, but potentially a contaminant. And actually her blood culture from the outside hospital also came back for the strep intermedius. So the bacteria was throughout her entire body. She had a bacteremia. So under the direction of our infectious disease team, we discontinued the vancomycin. At that point, the strep was susceptible. We didn't need it, and it was a nephrotoxic. We didn't want to cause any more damage. We continued her on the Rocephin and the Flagyl. Plan for brain abscess is minimum 6 to 8 weeks for any of these kids. And then she completed the Tamiflu during that time. So on hospital day 11 now, this is like about a week out after her second surgery, she started to open her eyes a little bit. And, you know, is she making eye contact? Is she tracking? I don't know. You know, it's kind of hard to tell sometimes. She had a cough, which is good when you're thinking about taking the patient off the ventilator. You worry about airway protection, secretion management. So if the patient doesn't have a cough, that's very concerning. But she actually did have a cough. She was having some movement on the left, which was awesome, but there was no movement on the right, which would make sense because all of her, remember the initial scans we showed, everything was there on the left. She had a repeat CT scan then on, hospital day 11 that was showing improving edema, improving midline shift. The one thing that kind of was a little concerning is it did show a new little pocket of fluid. So was this an abscess? Was this non-infectious fluid? So at this point, you know, we're cautiously optimistic, but always a chance that there could be another abscess that they potentially would have to go back in and drain. On hospital day 12, she had been pretty stable. So the neurosurgery team felt it was a good time to discontinue her ICP monitor since she was slowly improving. And then, hold on. Oh no. Then Oh gosh, sorry. She did it. We extubated. It was awesome. She got off the ventilator to non-invasive support. We were all a little bit worried. We had had family discussions about possibly needing a trach, about possibly needing some BiPAP or CPAP. So it was kind of one of those touch and go things, but she rocked it. Man, she did awesome, and she blew us all out of the water. She did have a little bit of a weak cough, so there's some things that we do with those kids that have impaired airway clearance, including cough assist and vest, but that was really it. She's a rock star. So kind of just post-PICU care, not to speed it up, but she did. She did fantastic. On hospital day 21, she was transferred out of the PICU. We were all very sad, but very happy that she got to graduate out of the ICU. She went to our specialty peds team on the floor. She continued to work with our rehab team and get stronger, and she ultimately graduated into our inpatient rehab program, which I just want to touch on that. This is something new, and it's very exciting for us. In September of 22, our physical medicine and rehab department opened Dayton Children's very first inpatient rehab facility. We have two beds at the time. There are two people there now. And it has been amazing. And I know this patient specifically, I had the chance to talk to her family, and they had nothing but wonderful things to say about our PT, our OT, our speech in inpatient rehab. You know, you have our PM and R docs, you have psychology, you have all the therapies, child life, including Millie, if you guys don't know our therapy dogs. I mean, it's just awesome. So she went to our rehab facility where she gets rehab 6 days a week, and it's no joke. They push you. There's a therapy gym. And so, and I won't give you the final results. I have a little surprise for you at the end. But she is doing better, and she's still on the IV Rocephin and Flagyl. I don't believe we have a final timeline for that now, but it's still 6 to 8 weeks. So just to give you an idea, a lot of these kids do have to go home with a PICC and are on IV antibiotics at home for 6 to 8 weeks. Going back to the hemicraniectomy picture that I showed you, the 3D construction that with the removal of the bone flap, the left side of the skull, that is still removed. She's awaiting a protective helmet. So obviously it's something that needs to be watched and stay protected. But when she gets that helmet, hopefully she'll be able to go home then. And at that time, about 6 weeks out after her last operation, the plan will be to take her back to the OR and insert a titanium mesh plate, which is conocranioplasty, and that will provide the protection that her skull once did. And she remains hospitalized. So, well, not hospitalized, in our inpatient rehab. So just to kind of recap everything as a whole, I just wanted to show you guys this case in particular, because I think it goes through all of, the pathophysiology, especially in the critical care world that we deal with as far as increased ICP. I think it shows a lot of the management of the brain abscess. And again, there's no evidence-based recommendations, but just to kind of recap the treatment pathway that we followed. Medical management, if possible. We do have some kids that come to our ICU that do not require surgery, that go home on IV antibiotics, and abscesses are resolved. So obviously that's the goal. But if you're a case like this, and the abscess is causing increased pressure on the brain, then there's no other choice but to have surgical management. You give broad spectrum IV antibiotics. And again, most of the bugs that they're finding, even with the CDC and even with our cases that we've seen here, they're pretty susceptible, not resistant, and treatable with the antibiotics that we have. Plus or minus high dose steroids for the cerebral edema. And this specific case study, she was on after the second surgery, we actually increased her high dose to higher dose steroids, and she was on that for 7 days post-op just because the cerebral edema was persistent and not getting better. Also plus or minus seizure prophylaxis, obviously depending upon where the lesion is located in the brain. Early and aggressive PTOT in speech, just shout out to our rehab program. Again, they are there on day one, you know, in the PICU. I talk to them daily, and they are awesome. And I cannot wait to show you the last part, because it just shows you exactly how awesome they are. And then last but not least, the goal for every patient is to transition to home, plus or minus an inpatient rehab. Prior to opening hours, this was always really challenging for families because really the only inpatient rehabs around here are Cincinnati and Columbus, and they're very difficult to get into. And typically if they have a patient that's there already, which they likely do, they kind of get first dibs on that rehab. So we're not always able to facilitate inpatient rehab. And there's so many studies to show that that is what you need. You need aggressive inpatient daily rehab to get the best recovery. So we were really, really excited to be able to provide that, not only for this case study, but also for our patients moving forward. So our case study, where is she now? And before I go on, I just want to say that I do have written consent from mom and actually from patient. She gave me her consent to show her face. You know, sometimes I think as medical professionals, we geek out about the medical stuff and the cool 3D reconstruction, but it can be hard, you know, to remember. And I think it's important to remember, you know, the person. And this is Addie. And Addie, I hope I didn't say your name before, but Addie is who I've been talking about and who has been with us. And just to remember, like, how impactful this is on Addie, on her family, on her friends, on her siblings, and just everything that we do day in and day out, it's huge. The spread is huge. So I just wanted to kind of bring back some perspective to that. And I also wanted to show a little video to let Addie show you just how well she's doing today. Maybe. Oh, I think he told me to do this. Hold on. Oh no, where did it go? Is he still in here? Anybody know how to get this to work? See, control. Okay, so what do I do? Oh, I got it. Okay.
Like a small boat on the ocean, sending big waves into motion, like how a single word can make a heart open. I might only have one. But I can make an explosion. And all those things I didn't say were wrecking balls inside my brain. I was screaming. She started walking into the stairs by herself without the water.
Addie, did you surprise Josh today with one of them? What was that?
I was expecting us to maybe take a couple steps without help, so. Constantly impressing,
yep.
Constantly blowing us away.
It's been an incredible progress. Every time I see Addie, it's way more than I expect to see.
So I started working with Addie right before she was shifting into the IDR program, and we did full assistance of all the people to get into sitting, to do any mobility. We had pretty minimal use of this right leg, and only now we don't. And just we needed so much help that our hopes and expectations for discharge were that we could help with some of the mobility. Maybe a stretch goal was a walker, and
we have still.
And then 2 weeks until what?
Still.
How a single word can make a heart open. I might only have one match, but I can make an explosion. This is my fight song. Take back my life.
Ring? What does this ring mean to you? You should be safe out. So that is Addie, and she deserves all of that.
Oh
no.
You got a big day today.
Sorry. And actually, she is so incredible, and her mom and dad are so incredible, and she's here with us today. Addie, can you just give a little wave? Hi. So, Addie, I told you before, and I'll say it again, you really are such an inspiration, and I hope you know how big of an impact you've had on all of us, how much you have taught us, how much your families have taught us, and you are a rock star, and there are so many kids that you're going to help through this story. So, thank you for letting me be the one to share your story, and you're awesome. So, that concludes the presentation. If anybody has any questions about anything, I know we have Dr. Patel and Dr. Claudia here, who are also experts on the topic. Any questions from anyone? Addie's family, anything? Nope. Okay. Awesome. Oh, you do? Yeah. Yes.
So besides us as outpatient providers, like recommending flu vaccines, and then as ED providers and acute care providers, like picking up all the signs of some intracranial process, is there anything in between? Because, you know, a lot of kids diagnosed with flu, maybe
right.
Kids that have a few days of sinus-like pain, is there any prevention of this that we can be acting on, or is it really just, you know, recommending the flu vaccine?
Well, no, that's a good question, because I actually asked the same, and I'll turn it over if you guys have anything to say. Dr. Claudia's like, nope. But I asked the same thing, and yes, flu vaccine. So if you can, there's studies on that that shows that that can help. And I also asked our ENT team in sinus rinses. So guess how many neti pots I have in my house now? My poor children. Sinus washes are very effective. And then, you know, treatment, this isn't documented. So this is, you know, just in speaking with, some of the ENT team, treatment of sinusitis. It was really funny. I think it was Dr. Vora, one of our, ICU docs, who was talking to a colleague from India, and he, you know, they were talking like, have you seen this as much? And they're like, well, no. And he's like, 'cause you Americans don't use any antibiotics, you know, like, I don't know the recommendation now. I'm so far out of the outpatient world, but you know, before it was, you let it go at least 14 days before treating. And I know all antibiotics are not the answer, but you know, it was just an interesting comment, right? That would be an interesting study to look into too. So just from my research, for this presentation, it really is just, sinus rinses are effective and going back to the doctor, but any rhyme or reason or be able to like truly prevent it, I don't believe there is. I don't know if anybody, any of our ICU team or ID people have anything to add. But
as far as prevention, other than what you mentioned about influenza, seasonal influenza vaccine, and what you mentioned about, even in cases where
not prevent an individual from getting the flu. It's been shown to still decrease the overall number of invasive secondary bacterial infections.
Is there any, I didn't look into this, I should have, Tamiflu. Is there, has anybody looked at that yet? I'm sure they will. So yeah, it, obviously more research is needed. And like I said, hopefully sometime here soon, I'll get to stand back up here and with the updated research and maybe some evidence-based guidelines on the treatment. But regardless, I think we have a pretty awesome neurosurgery, ENT, ID, ICU, rehab, neuro, every, I think like it's, Addie's results are incredible. So it's a very cool story to be a part of. Anybody else have any questions about anything? No? All right. Awesome. Well, thank you guys very much.
Yeah.